zvikavazopinda matongero ezvevashandi pamuzi vakanoerekwa kusasekitari 1988 Congress yekugwemu vakazosarudzwa kasekitari general wezimbabwe Congress Chairman. One might be aware that university was formed in 1980. Naturally, it was a pride of ZANU-PF because by then we know an organization that was fully representing and embracing the interests of the Africans at where it is. So when more the English with the people civil again, there was a strike at the University of Zimbabwe. Professor Kambara then is a leader at the university. But Changai joined because my students they were complaining and clamoring against this sort of corruption that they took place in this country. But what Changai was wisdom saying, no, if it's sexy to you, we need to intervene to make sure that you assist the students. He was arrested for 2 weeks. And unfortunately, he was affected by the arrest, and all Zimbabweans were affected by the arrest. He moved on after he realized that no, the problems that we have in this country will be able, no, not able to solve these problems unless we form a political party. Him with the other members of the Zimbabwe Congress Union, with the various students, including our president that we have today, they formed a political party. But before that, they formed National Constitutional Assembly in 1997-1998 and became a chair. So, on that stage, what do we remember? We remember for transforming Zimbabwe Congress Trade Union, as I said, ZCTU at its embryonic stage, at its nascent stage, it was the client and offshoot of ZANU-PF. But transform it from being a private example to a people representative Congress of Chapter. That's what we remember before. That's it. The very formed a political party, he formed a political party over to challenge the status shadows. He went on to win the presidency. And out of those seats that went to ZANU-PF, 20 were challenged those elections. Unfortunately, ZANU-PF went on to appeal to the Supreme Court and to Ghana. But in the processes, we also faced a lot of challenges like treason charge. You remember that our president was charged with trying to assassinate Robert Mugabe through a case that involved Albanian Caracons. He was acquitted on 15 October 2000. The political party is blocking and over its first lot of problems. With our own problems like in our trial organization. In 2005, our party faced some problems. 12 October 2005, some circumstances that were beyond the control of the president took place. But notwithstanding to that, 2005 again, we lost our member of parliament from Wunirimo Honorable Shoko. And with the by-election in the 2006 February, and won the election through Emmanuel Shoko. In 2003, when the final post was made by Morgan Tsvangirai from 2003, unfortunately, it was not allowed to take place because ZANU-PF was fearing and Morgan Tsvangirai was also arrested. We lost our cadre, Raymond Jombe, in 2002, necessitating a by-election. The election that was held on 3 March 2003 and Rachel Mitter became our member of parliament for Kwazulu Constituency. All through this process, one time the outcome was overturned by the people, which is very unfortunate. And he simply said, I think I'm coming from a 2-10 status. That outcome necessitated the formation of the inclusive government. Everyone will be a testimony with inclusive government, the last thing that is very important about MTV is our records. Unfortunately, I don't have time to delve into his personality within the other. But what he did, notwithstanding my differences, My last days, our master Badans and Kayes pro alliance, but I've visited nearly every village of this country. Consulting chiefs, consulting sabukus, consulting everyone who matters for the articulation of the future of this country. And all political individuals, but I can't relate to them at differences. So we simply say, this is our country together. Time ya wo tsha ba ku fa ba ka ti sika sa na re ba ba ka na tshi ma tshi ka tsha ba ba ka ti ba sa tsha ina tshi ba ka ti sika Joshua a ka po a tshi ba That's why you see today we are the best political apart not only in Zimbabwe across Africa because of the result. Other people may tend to compare us to the other political parties, but our way to development is totally different from those other environments. So we are very proud that we have a leader today who was born from these processes, went through the mill, and is doing his best to make sure that my Zimbabwe is ushered up in Nigeria. No project that let us see one number of ways to answer. It's a rare province, we thank you very much, and we feel more honored to host such an event. And first of all, let's have more time because our time today is to help, it is to dwell on the ideology that's supposed to be done by local commanders. So this was my preface, my preamble, to simply say the Morgan Richard Tsvangirai did his best and may his soul continue to rest in peace. Thank you very much.
Come on, 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 come on na mpunzi. Esse tu te diz o sul.
I have not come to give an ideology lecture. I When I was forced in retirement at this stable college, so I laughed. Why are you laughing? I said, you forgot that people were arrested from the stable college during the struggle. You sang about all those who were arrested for being too ideological. I'll come to that later. One of the challenges of our struggle is precisely lack of ideology. I'll come to that later. But I don't come here to get some ideology. I came here, normally I would have said I'm not institutional for religious. But Mungo Changarai was my young brother who became my boss. So I'm here to give my own personal recollections of this great man, one way, but also to reflect on his legacy and the lessons thereof. I first met Morgan Tsvangirai in 1981. A short week of mine. I just come back into the country. I came back with a ceasefire in 1980. And I was in charge of what they call manpower at that time. And I was doing the manpower survey. And I met Morgan Tsvangirai. Unfortunately, I remember very significantly a lunch I had with him at a restaurant in Adelaide. And he told me some insights about the state at that time of which I was part. Some shocking details, which some of which he refers to is biography. But I got to know him in particular December 1997, the biggest stairway in the history of Zimbabwe. It was a Tuesday. I drove to town. It was like a Sunday. But I was more than Tsvangirai's first emphatic participation in the history of this country. We should not forget that. 9th of December 1997. Just before that, the National Economic Consultative Forum, NECF, was formed, and I was head of the social contract section of the NECF. And it was my task and my committee to deal with Morgan Tsvangirai during the food riots of 1988. I don't know if you remember. That was an amazing show of force by the masters of this country. And we went to deal with Morgan. At that stage, anything would have happened. And fortunately, it related and the food riots were called off. In retrospect, I just wonder whether we did the right thing. We met again during the 1999 at the Constitutional Commission, of which I was a member, executive member. And I was working with the excellent Jomo. And my task was to mobilize all civic society into the Constitutional Commission. And I met with Morgan Tsvangirai several times, trying to persuade him to be part of the Constitutional Commission. My argument being that unless and until the mass movement was part of the constitutional making exercise, the exercise was futile. As it turned out, the Constitutional Commission coincided with the information of the ABC in September 1992. And understandably, Moge Tsvangirai declined to join the Constitutional Commission. The rest is history. I've got to know Moge more closely over the years. And I remember most significantly in 2017, August 2017, I received a phone call from the Yusuf Dabenga. He said, have you heard the news? He said, Moge has died. I said, well, he's still just close to me. Let me find out. So I phoned Moge. He said, Tsunara, you can hear I'm alive. Why don't you come over for coffee to show to prove I'm alive? Then I went with a long chat at his house in the Kew Drive. I was talking and not to see Moge thereafter until his untimely death. I've been asked to speak on Morgan's legacy as a life of service, a life of sacrifice. The life of service is obvious in his very history. Born 10th of March 1952, Moge would have been 70 in 2 years' time. A young man. He became Institute Secretary General in 1988. And as I've said earlier, in 1999, as the chairman of the Harare Province has outlined much of Moge's service to the community, to this country. You are not just an MDC president. Moge was a leader in this country. For me, as I'll say in my conclusion, Moge is one of our heroes in this country.
Yes.
But I want to speak more about the life of sacrifice. Because Morgan's life, political life, coincides with immense suffering. A reference has been made to the incident of 2007. March 11th. Yes, I remember that. And I was one of the many who went to the hospital to see Moge and others injured, including Nelson Shalisa, that didn't remember seeing me. Yes, we thought we were losing. I was unconscious. Completely unconscious for days. He's lucky to be alive. We're lucky in that sense. There's no way one can exaggerate Moge Tsvangirai was brutalized in this country. Harassed. Accusations, treason twice, 2002, again in 2003. And even though it was a travesty, almost a comic strip in the history of this country. There is no telling how much he suffered. But as a former detainee myself, yes, you suffer, but your family suffers more.
Yeah.
And can you imagine the suffering that the family went through during those days?
Yeah.
I met Bezos, who was a lawyer, during Moge's so-called treason trial. We flew together and sat next to him from the plane, the flight from Joburg to Cape Town, 2 hours. And he told me all. He could not understand the inhumane behavior of this modern state. and the suffering that Morgan Tsvangirai went through. And it was a sad indictment of this country. And to know that we are still in that situation is most depressing. Throughout his political life, Tsvangirai was a victim of state-sponsored harassment, violence, and intimidation. And it is difficult to isolate the death of his wife Susan from that array of harassment and suffering in 2009. But for me, my main subject is on his legacy, as I said earlier. His legacy and the lessons that we must learn from him as governors, in particular as the opposition in this country, especially at this juncture. The first of his legacy is that through Morgan Tsvangirai and the MDC, Zimbabweans in general have learned to realize the limitations of the liberation struggle. From one which we eulogized, and even if though we are part of it, some of us, we have learned through the MDC to Morgan Tsvangirai of the glaring limitations of the liberation movement. That yes, it brought independence, but it lacks the capacity to turn around this country. It lacks the skills, let alone the ideology, through which to overcome the vestiges of colonialism in this country. And this explains the political malaise, the economic depression that we're suffering. There are men and women there who have no clue over what it means, what even to start the economic development. I say so as being one of them. I was in government for 10 years, to 1990. We did wonders in the early part of the 80s. But if you look back, the limitations were already there. We could not, our base of successes, education, manpower planning, became in the end our worst enemies. There were no jobs. No expansion in the economy. And therefore, the courage to stand post-colonial state, to say no, enough is enough, which looks very obvious now. In the 1980s and 1990s, it felt almost yes. Therefore, Morgan's courage, bravery, is second to none. We'll always be ready for that. Even if, as we have now learned, that the rise of the opposition, the MDC in particular, in 1999, gave birth to what we have described as secular state, which we have now. And in doing so, it exposed the liberation movement, the former liberation movement, as all illusions of ideology, the kind of stuff you heard of it, was clearly, not to mention the empty policies, the flaw, the failure to turn this country ground. What we've seen as to the expectations of economic development, the development of a very ugly class, which we call the comrade class. The term comrade is a Chinese term for ages of individualism, ages of capitalism. The France, in the African situation, is only because it's worse than that. It's a class of thieves. Thieves. What do you call them? Cartels? So our country, when you can't explain how a civil servant, an army official, officer, can be a billionaire on the basis of $1,500 a month. And all questions that become a culture. You didn't take it for granted. Each time the divorce proceedings, one of these comrades, half the page of the Eastern School, the list of properties they own, 40 gold watches, and houses, cars, every day. And what worries me is that it almost become a culture, because even you in opposition don't seem to courage it enough in terms of explaining its origins, in terms of trying to diagnose the illness on the basis of which, when you are in power, you don't dare do the same. And this curse, this comparable class that is ruling this country, running this country in both the public and the private sector, in the military, in the security, is that which explains the kind of tension we have in the country. This is the current state. And the coup, which some of you decided not to call a coup in 2017, and what did you do with this class?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And power retention is largely to do with this class. They're afraid of tomorrow. They're not sleeping. They don't know what tomorrow will bring for them. So, through the opposition in this country, to the MPC, we have one of the few instances in the post-liberation situation, and you should pride yourself on this. There's been no such opposition movement in Angola, Mozambique, even South Africa. And therefore, the legacy of Morgan Tsvangirai is remembered in that context. The first to stand up to post-colonial stage, fighting the white of the Ethiopian fear in comparison. As much as we want to realize the struggle, the real struggle has been in the post. This is the most ardent of the struggles of the country. Secondly, one of the lessons we've learned, therefore, from the struggle itself, from Morgan Tsvangirai, is that there are no shortcuts to progress.
Yeah.
We need to understand the nature of the state. We need to study more carefully. We have tried. We said that we did not see things as what they were in 2017. Betrays a certain poor understanding of the state. We didn't share that euphoria that some of you much. We saw it what it was because we knew this animal, this bunch of thieves that are in power. It was partly about thieving that the coup took place. So if you understand the nature of the state, of all its character, and analyze who it, the easier it is to confront it and beat it sooner than later. Thirdly, we need also to learn this revolutionary movement that the opposition in this country is more than the ANC. And therefore, if you want to complete this process, then it's important, President Chamisa, that you unite all opposition in this country. But in doing so, you're also uniting the country.
Yes.
98% of this country is against ZANU-PF. Someone said 99.9. That's a fact. And you see, we have to learn also that elections are not enough.
Yeah.
And bringing into elections, as we have done since 2000, religiously, with much expectation, the most cynical disregard for the popular voice.
Yeah.
I was very sore in 2013 in particular, when I had gone out to the US and to the UK, mobilizing the diaspora to come back home, because by all indications, it was clear that I was losing the election. It was so clear. Anyone on the streets knew that Mugabe could not win the election. Also, I knew, because of the position I held and the access I had to the state, I knew in 2002 that more than China had won. I would have called 4 a.m. at home. And that is you are. Now, when the press conference in the party building, the wedding day, they were looking very sad, serene. Until now, the chairman of the photo people that said, I was shocked to hear the same people who had told me at 4 a.m. that Daraj was saying, ah, Daraj. Now, I don't think this is anyway, but I can tell you that soon after that, Mbeki and Obasanjo, in fact, I went to Obasanjo in the Ask Education Forum. When he arrived in 2002, at midnight, he sent a vehicle to my phone, picking up a man. And he says, people are still good. I still heard that all is lost. It's an incident of information. Yeah. phone calls in the morning, a bit open that night, Saturday, Sunday night, getting drunk in the homes, from killing, and so on and so forth. And the rest is history. The point I'm making is there was open possession, and we know in days he was still wrong with the regime.
Now, we know, as political economists, a national transition
national authority is usually an option that for the opposition to put the cards on the table, good enough to put a mechanism on the table. That this government has no capacity to turn around this country. It appears that the leadership in government are looking for a face-saving exit.
Yes.
Help them. Yeah, help them. Yes. As I've said before, Morgan, it was one of you is along with those from the first to the Gabriel to the week. Along the vegetables, and I believe stories, Joshua and Paul, and so on and so forth. So I hope one day, also in my life, I will give Morgan Shangri-La the latest honor and recognition for being one of Zimbabwe's heroes. Thank you.
That we build a convergence platform. We'll try our best.
platform has to be a convergence of the like-minded. A convergence of people who have different views can actually be a recipe for disaster. So yes, there are a lot of people who underestimate and undervalue the platform of the MDC. What you are seeing here is evidence of how the Tsvangirai is not division.
True.
Members of parliament, mayors, councillors, the quest and hunger for change. This man we are celebrating is a man who was a finalist. It's not as nice we are there before. We will build the alliance, we will continue to converse people. But there are people who are moving around to say, MDC people are desperate. It's usually come from the MDC. Yes, we are desperate. But we are not desperate for power, we are desperate for change.
Yeah.
They think that when we talk about dialogue, we want to convey so that we are in a GDU. President Tsvangirai told us lessons. We laid our lessons in the GDU. No more GDU.
Yes,
the transitional authority. So that we create an environment that takes way for a new dispensation.
Yes, yes.
So we are not under any illusion. We will not compromise. Public balance will not betray this love.
Yeah.
We will not betray because the master has given us the song. All we have to do is to dance to that song. And we are good dancers.
Uh-huh.
And this song,
yes,
the song of change, the song of prosperity. The song that we are going to play, not just in Zimbabwe, but in the whole world.
Yes.
That song shall run.
Yes.
That song shall run. The song that we are going to see honor. That which our icon left us as a seed of development, as a seed of a bright future, as a seed of a new beginning, as a seed of where we must go. He showed us the way. We must walk the way. And we must go there. We'll get there. A lot of you think that, no, it takes me too long. No. It gets darkest just before God.
Yeah.
It's almost time. Dr. Mandas, don't worry about what this regime is doing. We have people who are strong. We are mobilizing right now. We will have mass action in this country like never seen before. We are doing it because that is what we are told by Morgan Chandra. When you try to dialogue with people who are deaf and dumb, you must teach them through your language of peace. Because peace is a language that is used against dictators. Peace is a language that is used against tyrants. Peace is the language that will succeed.
Thank you.
And we'll use it.
Yes.
And we'll win. So thank you for coming, colleagues, members of the diplomatic corps, our members of parliament. You have heard for yourself from none other than Professor Manasseh Tsvangirai on what you must prioritize. Thank you, Professor, prioritize. And not my people. Thank you very much. Thanks to our Dr. Manasseh. Thank you, Ramli. We really appreciate it. Thank you very much. We appreciate Comrade Wende. Well done for organizing this function. We are going to lead and liberate this country. It is you and me who have to do it. No turning back. Yes, it will be tough. They will try to kill us. They will try to shoot us. But I want to tell you, nobody who uses guns is going to die. Whoever uses guns is a coward.
Yeah.
Because, you know, courageous people don't use guns. They use open hands. Open hands of trust. And that's where we belong. So thank you. I don't want to say much. So thank you. It's very, very. This man is the definition of he's the one who taught us the way. That's why Dr. Mandela took his letters. We have now considered the Morgan Tsvangirai School of Ideology Development. It's for us to have the ideological anger. We must have a theory to our practice. Because this morning you come and love a deal. And that deal is suffering most. We are thinking about the beginning of justice, solidarity, and freedom. So one thing of their promises in God is flowing out of the rivers of justice, out of the oasis of justice, out of that well. We have always said it is important, the well of solidarity. That's who we are as enemies. So we teach people not to brainwash them, but to make sure that we brain strengthen so that they are ideologically anchored for the future and to be able to continue to be the anchors of a new civilization and a new ideological culture. So yes, we're very studied. We are not like any stable where people go there for discipline, where they are taught to be out of line. Ours is not a disciplinary mechanism. You know, it is a distillational platform where people are distilled in terms of thought processes, in terms of ideological income to be able to provide that opportunity. We are also going to go beyond. Morgan Tsvangirai Foundation is coming. We are discussing with the family. Because this man must have a foundation, even if they use Zimbabwe, to teach people about democracy, to teach people about justice, to teach people about tolerance. Marole Wale for president in Nambari, Korea. For him to have a government, inclusive government, takes a lot of courage. But the man was very forgiving. And that's what we must learn from. It's good that we are not together, but we continue to inspire so that we are able to forgive. Thank you, leadership. Thank you for the day more of this ideological and memorial lecture series, because we want to continue this as a tradition. Thank you. This is our moment. This is our chance. How many of you are ready? How many of you are ready? Thank you very much. This is our call. This is our church. Thank you for all organizers. Thank you for the effort. Of course, I saw that you were using this opportunity to showcase yourselves. So we understand. Thank you so much. Our veterans of the struggle, welcome to support. May you continue to be committed to this struggle. And God bless you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, President, for those final and closing remarks. I'll call upon Honorable Machaya to give us a closing prayer, please. Should go to Kansas, so we started the game. Should go to Mongolia, we started to get on to Korea.